This is the FM Gold channel of All India Radio. In the program News Analysis, we now bring you a discussion on significance of Prime Minister's visit to Singapore. The participants are Shashi Ubhan Tripathi, former diplomat, and Indrani Bakshi, journalist.
We will take a closer look at Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit to Singapore for the East Asia Summit. Among other things, he's expected to not sign, but at least conclude negotiations on the Regional Economic Partnership, which is the biggest trading arrangement in the Asian region. This will be Prime Minister's second trip to Singapore in the current year. He was there in June to be the keynote speaker at the Shangri-La Dialogue, where Mr. Modi laid out the contours of India's Indo-Pacific policy. That will be taken forward because the second meeting of what is called the quadrilateral, which is a grouping, an informal grouping of four nations, that is the US, Japan, India and Australia, will be meeting at the senior official level for the second time this year. Ambassador Tripathi, can you give us a sense of what you think will be the more important parts of Prime Minister Modi's visit?
You've mentioned the broad outlines, of course, but this trip of Prime Minister Modi to Singapore, mainly to participate in the East Asia Summit, is an important one, because you remember we used to have something called the Look East policy.
Right.
And then the Prime Minister, when he came into power, he gave it a different nuance and he called it the At East policy, thus making it more proactive. Proactive not only in words, but also in action and in our collaboration with these countries. Now, from that flowed the Indo-Pacific policy and, of course, the East Asia policy, or the At East policy, which will be taken forward at this summit meeting that starts tomorrow. Now, the focus of this East Asia summit, which is a summit between 10 ASEAN countries plus 6 important countries of the region, namely India, China, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand. Now, the focus in this meeting, I think, is going to be on the RCEP, or the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And as you know, negotiations on this RCEP have been going on since 2012.
6 years.
At the ASEAN Summit in Cambodia. And it's been 6 years now. It's been a painstaking process. But that is because there are so many countries involved, and also because each country has its own concerns. Each country wants the best deal for itself, while also interacting with the region as such. So that is why it's taken so long.
But
I believe that the negotiations are now down to the wire, and they are, as you mentioned, at the finalization stage.
India has this reputation in the region of being hesitant on trade negotiations, on trade agreements. And this particular agreement, the RCEP, is actually scaring India, because it will be the only time that India will have some kind of an agreement with China at a multilateral level. How much of a problem is that for us?
There are reasons for India to be wary of Chinese economic power. As it is, you know that our balance of trade with China is deeply in the negative. That's one. Now, if in this multilateral forum again, we are to open up our market, or 92% of the goods as they are demanding, then our markets will be overwhelmed. The fear is that we might be overwhelmed.
Yes.
Now, of course, it is for our own industries and our manufacturing sector to take precautions. But that is the fear. Now, India has already made an offer of opening up its market to 76% for these and 86% for the other ASEAN countries. But they want 92%.
Yeah.
So there we are a little hesitant. Mm. Now, the second point is that we want them to open their markets for our goods and services, particularly the services sector, which would involve the free movement of skilled professionals.
Mm.
And on that, they are hesitant. They are not just interested. So this is where the sticking point comes in.
However, after 6 years, I think we may have some kind of progress that they might be able to announce. Whether we actually conclude the negotiations this time or not, I'm not certain that they will, actually, because there aren't too many chapters that they have closed, as they say, for the negotiations. Besides, there seem to be concerns in some countries like Indonesia, India, Australia, that they have elections coming up and they might want to sort of roll this over for 2019. Is that your sense, is that?
Yes, I think so. That is a genuine concern of the political setup in these countries. Because however good an agreement is, there's bound to be criticism on something or the other.
Right.
And I feel maybe these governments don't want that at this
just
stage,
before
just
the
before elections. The elections come in. So that's one point, and they would like to postpone it till after the elections are over. The second thing is that, as you rightly pointed out, this agreement is now at the conclusive stage. And although it won't be complete, I don't think it can be concluded this time. But some understanding will have to be reached so that it is concluded next year, whenever next year. Now, the sticking point there again is that in the draft of this agreement, there's a mention of the agreement having come to substantial conclusions. And this phrase, substantial conclusions, has problems, especially for a country like Malaysia, where it has legal implications.
That's right.
Which means they will have to divulge the nuances, not just nuances, the details of whatever they have agreed to their parliament and to the media. And they are wary of that. Let's see how this goes.
Of course, countries like Japan, Australia, even China to some extent, are fairly keen that this goes through. And I suspect the overhang there is the US-China trade conflict that is currently underway. But that is certainly one part. I think that is something that everybody will be watching over the next couple of days. But the other thing that we will be watching is progress or progression of the Indo-Pacific. As you know, the US president will not be there, but he's sending the Vice President, Mike Pence. And I think Prime Minister Modi will have a meeting with him. What is your sense of how the Indo-Pacific policy moves forward?
I feel that the U.S. would like to see more of Indian involvement on the military plane in this region, not just economic, but also military and strategic. And there might be some discussions on that. Now, we have always been wary of our military presence in Asia or even Afghanistan, you already know. And I don't think it will come to selling your boots on the ground kind of thing. Not that. But something by way of cooperation in the high seas, for instance, or the Indian Ocean, because the maritime, that dimension is taking a huge dimension. And there are fears in many countries, not just the US and India, but also the countries of the region about China's growing presence.
Yes.
And if I may say so, aggressive presence in many ways in this region and upon the seas.
Yes.
You know, we know what is happening in the South China seas. So I feel that this Indo-Pacific may take some form of collaboration in that sphere also.
That's right. So there is the Indo-Pacific India wants to promote is an Indo-Pacific that Prime Minister Modi has said at the Shangri-La Dialogue. He calls it inclusive, and where he puts the sort of the fulcrum, the focus of the policy in ASEAN. ASEAN itself is, in a sense, divided between huge neighbor like China and a huge trading partner like China and an even bigger presence like the US and newer powers in the region like India. The play between these powers, I think, will determine how far or how benign the Indo-Pacific actually remains. There will be a meeting, of course, of the quadrilateral nations, which is, as you know, India, US, Japan and Australia. I think it is at the Indian insistence that it is at remains at the senior official level, the broad understanding that India doesn't want to completely anger China. How much of this China fear is legitimate?
You know, I feel we shouldn't get paranoid about China. But the fact is that we have to be realistic and go by actual condition on the ground. Now, China's rise is a welcome thing. I mean, we all said 21st century belongs to Asia. So China and India are the two biggest countries and they are moving very fast. There were the Asian tigers also before us. This is consolidation of the Asia story. But over the years, China's move, not just in Asia, but in Africa and elsewhere, especially the developing world, has not just been fast, but has had an element of aggression to it. And that gives a certain unease to countries of the region, especially of Asia and East Asia. Mm. And I said countries like Philippines, for instance, or Vietnam, which have a lot to do with China, will naturally, they will be hesitant to voice these fears very openly. One can understand that, but that those anxieties are there. Mm. And I feel that is why they want India to be present in this area to balance the China factor.
And the problem there being that, is India ready to balance China? Because China, for instance, is 5 times our size. It is now an $11.5 trillion economy. We are at $2.5 trillion economy. Is India the natural balance for China? Or is India a competitor for China? Or is India both? And if we look at the India-China relationship in 2018, after the Doklam crisis last year, would you say that there has been a turnaround in the India-China relationship in this year?
No, I agree there that competition does not mean confrontation.
Right.
It shouldn't at all. It's a very simplistic way of looking at things.
Right.
And I think by now, India is also feeling a little more comfortable vis-a-vis China. And I think China maybe is beginning to understand where we come from. We don't want confrontation, but we also want our space. We are a rising country, economically especially, and nobody can counter that and shouldn't.
Right.
And we can work together. And this is what the statements coming out of China recently have also mentioned that. But having said that, the balance that we want to keep is one of cooperation and not confrontation. You said, can India be a viable power?
Right.
Now, it's often said that India is a powerful country who doesn't know how to exercise its power. Mm. Maybe we have this experience of colonialism and all that has made us diffident. And it's only now that we are coming into our own and feeling more self-confident in the global arena.
That is actually true, because one of the things that we hear from a lot of other countries is, why are you not more proactive? Why are you not out there a lot more? And I think the diffidence is very much in the Indian psyche as well. However, the relationship to watch as in Asia grows, and I think one of the principles of India's outreach both to Asia as well as in the Indo-Pacific is to ensure, I think, that Asia remains multipolar. We have an anathema for unipolar or bipolar worlds. We would like Asia to be multipolar, and with India as one of the poles, the other poles being China, Japan, Korea, Australia, Singapore. I think to wrap up, I wanted to ask you about Prime Minister's sort of relationship with Singapore. I mean, Prime Minister takes time out every time to sort of praise Singapore. In many ways, he gets inspired by the cleanliness in Singapore, by the way it is managed, etc. Has that been the same for all Indian leaders, or is Mr. Modi special in this respect?
I think Modi is a little different.
Yes.
It's a little different. And he has a vision for the country, let's face it, he does. And so wherever he goes, he looks for things which might be duplicated in our own country. And I think he does admire Singapore for being a small state, you know, city-state kind of, without any resources, which has done so well for itself. So I think it's an inspirational story.
Well, thank you so much, Ambassador Tripathi.
Thank you, Indrani.
You were listening to a discussion on significance of Prime Minister's visit to Singapore. The participants were Shashi Ubhan Tripathi, former diplomat, and Indrani Bakshi, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. This program is also available on our website newsonair.nic.in. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.